WTTW, in association with Marshall Field & Company, presents The Storyteller.
I dwell among the heroes of your favorite stories. Come, share with me the adventures of reading. Hello, my friends. Welcome once more to the bookshelves of the Storyteller. I have a story about a king who had the most extraordinary taste. And what that taste was is the title of our book. Let's take a look at it, shall we? It's called Pickle-Chiffon Pie, written and illustrated by Jolly Roger Bradfield and read by permission of Rand McNally and Company, the publishers and the copyright owners. Pickle pie. Do you know what a pickle pie is? Have you ever tasted one? Well, neither have I, but I don't suppose we should tell the king that it may not be very good. He wouldn't believe us anyway, would he? No. After all, it doesn't really matter what you like as long as you don't force it on others. Let's find out what the king, what problems he had with his pickle chiffon pie. A long time ago, there was a fat little king who rolled over the land as far as he could see in every direction. He was very wise, and his kingdom was a happy one. His wife, the queen, kept his castle spotless and saw that his robes were cleaned and pressed. She was a very good cook, and she made him a pickle chiffon pie every day. But everybody has problems, and the king had a daughter. Oh, she was very nice, did whatever he told her to, but she was also very beautiful, and every prince in the neighborhood wanted to marry her. Every day they came to the palace with flowers and gifts for her. To be polite, she would ask them all to stay for supper. And that meant there would be less pickle chiffon pie for the king. That was his problem. But finally, one day the king decided that his daughter should marry one of the princes. Then, at least, there would be fewer people at the dinner table each night. He called for the three nicest princes and told them that they would be put to a test and that the winner could marry the princess. The first, Prince Musselbaum, was very strong, very brave. The princess liked him because he was tall and he had wavy hair and freckles. The second, Prince Wellred, was very smart. He could count up to 684 and he read books 3 inches thick. The princess liked him too because he read beautiful stories to her and sometimes played music under her window at night. The third, Prince Bernard, wasn't very strong, or very handsome, or very smart. But the princess liked him best of all. He didn't really know why she liked him. Perhaps it was because he had a big smile and a funny nose. It's hard to tell about princesses. The king told the three princes this. You will each go into the huge forest at the edge of the kingdom for 3 days. As you know, it is full of gazoos, fairies, dimdoozles, all sorts of unusual things. The one who brings back the most unusual, the most marvelous, the most wonderful thing may marry the princess. Now remember, be back in 3 days. Musselbaum was delighted. Being stronger and braver than the others, he thought he would surely win. And with a shout, he jumped onto his horse and galloped off in the direction of the forest. At first, he didn't see anything unusual. Just a few small dragons, a troll peeking out of a tree, a medium-sized giant, the usual things one sees in a forest. But finally, looking behind a huge boulder, he did see something different. A green and blue dragon with three heads, toasting marshmallows.
Now, there's something you don't see every day, thought Prince Musselbaum. But I have two more days. I'll look a bit more.
On the second day, he saw a four-wheeled dimdoozle wearing glasses and smoking a pipe.
Now, there's something different, thought Musselbaum. I've never seen a dimdoozle smoking before. Ooh, but I have one more day. I'll look a bit more.
On the third day, he saw something really different. A huge lion juggling six cans of root beer soup. He was wearing a velvet vest and roller skates.
Ooh, this must surely be the most wonderful thing in the whole forest,
cried Prince Musselbaum. And bravely he grabbed the lion's tail and started dragging him back toward the castle. Meanwhile, Prince Wellred was searching too. The first day, he spied a witch who could turn people into frogs, which really wasn't so special, except that she could do it with her eyes shut and one hand behind her back. Now there's something you don't see every day, thought Wellred. But I have two more days. I'll look a bit more. On the second day, he saw a 16-footed gazoo that had a different kind of shoe on each foot. Now there's something different, thought Wellred. I've never seen a gazoo with more than 7 feet. But I have one more day left. I'll look a bit more. On the third day, he came upon something really different. A giant with a green beard, playing chopsticks on two pianos. Oh, why, this must surely be the most wonderful thing in the forest, cried Prince Wellred. I've never heard that tune before. He cleverly told the giant what a fine piano player he was, and he talked him into going back to the castle to play for the king. Now, let's not forget Prince Bernard. He was searching too, you know. On the first day, he met an ogre so ugly that he scared the leaves right off the trees. Now, there's something you don't see every day, thought Bernard. But he might frighten the princess if I brought him back. I have two more days. I'll look a bit more. On the second day, he discovered a tiny house tucked behind a tree. He peeked in, and he saw that it was filled with mice, all busily painting the most wonderful pictures. Now there's something different, thought Bernard. But it really wouldn't be right to stop such happy, hard-working little fellows right in the middle of their work. I have one more day. I'll look a bit more. On the third day, he saw something really different. A three-nosed snozzle with fuzzy ears and an orange polka dot necktie. And it was busy making pickle-chiffon pie. This must surely be the most wonderful thing in the whole forest. I thought the queen was the only one who could make pickle chiffon pie. Oh, the king will be so happy. And with that, he grabbed the snozzle's necktie and started leading it back toward the castle. Prince Bernard had never been happier in his whole life. Oh, it was hard work pulling the three-nosed snozzle through the forest, but Prince Bernard didn't mind. He was sure that he would win the contest to marry the princess. But he wasn't quite so happy when he saw how sad the snozzle looked. Oh, don't feel bad, said Bernard. You'll like living at the palace. It's much nicer than this dark old forest. And anyway, I have to take you back in order to marry the princess. And then Bernard noticed several tiny snozzles peering out from behind the trees. Why, aren't they cute, he said. Are they your children? The three-nosed snozzle nodded, with big, wet tears coming into its eyes.
What will happen to them when you're gone? Do they have anyone to take care of them?
The Snozzle shook his head sadly. Prince Bernard sat down on a log to think. He thought of his love for the princess. He thought of the Snozzle's love for its children. For a long time, it was very quiet and very still in the forest. Finally, with a sigh, the prince let go of Snozzle's necktie and watched it scamper off. And then he turned and walked slowly toward the castle. His 3 days were up. When all the princes were called to appear before the king, Musselbaum had a big smile on his face. He was sure that he would win with his juggling lion. Wellred was smiling too. He was just as sure that he would win when the king heard the giant play his two pianos. Bernard hung his head sadly as he stood empty-handed behind the others. Well, the king was delighted with Musselbaum's lion. "Oh, wonderful!" he cried, as the lion juggled 23 apples and a bottle of ketchup. And when Wellred's giant played chopsticks on his two pianos, the king laughed and clapped his hands in delight. "Oh, how wonderful!" he cried. "So unusual!" And then he turned to Bernard. "And what have you brought back?" he asked. Prince Bernard bowed low before the king. He hoped that no one noticed the tears in his eyes as he raised his head and said softly, "Nothing, Your Majesty." And then he told of meeting the ugly ogre who might have frightened the princess. He told of seeing the amazing mice whose painting he could not bring himself to interrupt. He told of the tiny Snozzle children that he could not bear to leave in the forest alone. And there was silence in the castle. No one spoke for a long time. Old Bernard wanted to run away and hide. Everyone was looking at him. Everyone, that is, except the princess and the queen. They were whispering to the king. The king nodded his head and smiled. And in a very loud voice he said, "Bernard, you have won the right to marry the princess."
But why, Your Majesty? I didn't bring back anything, said Bernard.
"Oh, yes, you did, my son. You brought back a story of kindness and love and consideration for others. Truly the most wonderful thing of all. You'll make a very fine husband for my daughter." And when Bernard married the princess, Wellred's giant played the wedding march, and Musselbaum's lion put on a special exhibition to entertain the guests. And guess who sent Bernard and the princess the biggest pickle-chiffon pie anyone ever saw for a wedding present? That's right. The three-nosed Snozzle with the fuzzy ears and the orange polka dot tie. You like that story?
So do I. You found out what the most wonderful thing, not only in the forest, but in all the world is? Love and kindness. That's all the time we have. And so, my friends, until we meet again, may your hours be spent in the adventures of reading.
Storyteller is made possible by a grant from Marshall Field & Company. Books used on the program are provided by the Book Department of Marshall Field & Company.